Thank you. Amen. Can we give the Lord a clap offering, church? Come on. Those of you at home, what are you grateful for? You know, they had a line in there that really kind of spoke to me that we've been talking about, which is that God is good. Let me say it again. God is good. I think we need to really remember that as we enter into this Advent season. Can you believe it's Advent? The first Sunday that we celebrate Advent, we celebrate the hope. The hope. In fact, that's part of our mission statement here at Broadcast, is to broadcast the love and the hope of Jesus Christ to Hampton Roads. What's your hope? Where have you put your hope? Our hope is found in nothing less than Jesus Christ and His righteousness. Amen. You know, I'm excited for today. I know that we have a lot of people home watching online, whether they're traveling. I know we have a lot of sick children. I actually can sing through most of the songs today without choking today, which is good. And I was just thinking and just praising God for His faithfulness through that song. I know we have many struggling physically.
some are even struggling emotionally at this time. And we just want you to realize and remember that there's a hope. There's a hope in Jesus Christ. If you're visiting with us, you're new, please fill out that connection card. We want to get to know you. We don't want to harass you, but we definitely want you to be connected to a life-giving body of believers. And a lot of our small groups are kind of taking a break for this month. We've got a lot going on, but get connected. Stay connected. In January, we're kicking off all of our engagement groups again for the Kids Squad Jam. I have some kind of special stuff I've been brewing in my heart over the last couple of months that I really want to introduce that for the first of the year. So I want to tell you guys that the baby bottle campaign, where we pick up baby bottles, you'll be able to pick up those next week. And we fill them up with change, or I challenge you to put in some greenbacks, some dollar bills, and also write out some checks to the Crisis Pregnancy Center. They are who we support this month in December. And so our baby bottle campaign will kick off next week. So make sure you pick up that. If you're at home and you can't get here, please, you can make donations online. Just make sure that you earmark it for the Crisis Pregnancy Center, or you can put baby bottle campaign, and we will get the money to them. Before we go into our next time of worship, I just want us to focus our hearts. Focus on our hearts, and I want you to think about the process. I've just really been thinking through this. What's the process that God has you in right now? Where is that? How is He refining you? How is He making you new and more like His Son as we're being transformed into His image? And I think if we do that and we cultivate this heart of love and gratitude, I believe that it will really set us up for an amazing Christmas Advent season. I don't know about you guys, but I could use it, man. I know that I want to just really bring in Christmas and with the right spirit, with the right heart. So let's just go to the Lord, if you would. Please stand with me as I pray and we go into this next set of worship songs. Holy Spirit, you are our guide, our great counselor. And I'm praying right now that the Holy Spirit speak over each and every one of us, whether you're watching online or home, whether you're watching in the future or you're here now. Holy Spirit, speak to us. Speak to our hearts. Lead us into all truth. And guide us, Lord, as we learn to implement your will and your way, and we learn to fully submit our lives to you. Help us, Lord, to trust the Father. Wherever we're at, we love you.
For Jesus, in your suffering, you saw. for that song was made for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the devil was from their good, and the angel stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored, and the souls of the bride for the home, and as the
Thank you.
series today. We've been on quite a bit of a journey, and I just want to say this, that sometimes you do a message, and you might be in one of these stages of the process, and you may not be at the next stage yet, but I want you to think back to this series down the road. I promise you, this series is something that I think you're really going to take hold of, and you're going to remember, and you're going to learn how to implement the leading of the Holy Spirit as we walk this thing out. Before I get into today's service, I just want to say that I got up here earlier and I had it all in my mind what I wanted to say, and then I was like, I got up here and it just went, you know, you ever had that moment? Just, you know, whoa, and then I was like, all right, I don't even know where I'm going with this, but I hope it was good. I don't even remember what it said, but I hope it was good. But what I want you to do is, those of you gathering at home, are you here? I want you guys to make sure that you like and are following our Facebook page as well as our Instagram page, because, church, we purchased a home. Now, some of you don't know what I'm talking about, but broadcast for the last year, it's been over a year process, but we have been looking at buying a flip house through Habitat for Missions, and we are going to flip a house as a church, and then we are going to donate all the proceeds to mission work, as well as locally to our local church network to help plant more churches, life-giving, Jesus-loving, God-fearing, Holy Spirit-filled type churches right here in Hampton Roads. Is that not awesome, church? Come on. I think God is dreaming up new things and new ways for God's church, because I really believe this is going to be a ministry. I'm going to be posting pictures each week as we're doing work on the home. But I want you, as we go into this project, I want you to remember this. I want you to think about this. When I look at this house, I think a lot of my own house, my spiritual house. And sometimes it might be broken. It might need a little fixing up, if you know what I mean. And the first thing we're going to do is we're going to clean up. And then we're going to go inside and we're going to take out all the stuff that needs to be cleared out. And we're going to start from the floor joists all the way up, aren't we, Stephen? Yeah? And we're going to transform this. But as we do this, I'm going to have fun with this. We're going to be doing some live, you know, devotionals. And we're going to do our men's group meetings there. And as we transform this house, I want you to think about what God is doing to you. And so we're going to use this as a really fun way. So make sure that you're following our Facebook page, our Instagram page, because we're going to try to just give a bunch of updates about what God is doing, because I don't think we're just flipping a house here. I believe that God's wanting to do something bigger and use this as a true ministry in our community. And so I'm very, very, very excited about that. But in the midst of that, you know what I found, and a question that I get asked by many of you at home, what's the meaning of life? Like, well, what's my purpose? I find that many of us are still trying to figure that out. Doesn't matter if you're 30, 40, 50, 60 years old. But we want to have meaning. We want to have purpose. And what we've been talking about spiritually over the last month is the fact that there's a process that happens. That you didn't just show up on Thursday and there was a great meal. Like, there was actually a process that happened from the farm that seed was planted, or that egg was hatched. And there was a process that it took to get from the farm to your table. And many of us don't even understand or recognize the process on the onslaught. We just show up. And I think in our culture, we're so used to just showing up and things just being done instantaneous, right? But if we aren't careful, we lose sight of the fact that there was a process involved, a very detailed process to go from the farm to your table. And I think spiritually, God does the same thing with us. And so what we've been looking at all month long is this spiritual process. It's going from lost to found. There's nothing better than the lost being found. Amen? There's nothing better than coming into the realization that I need Jesus and that I have become found. Jesus spoke about it in his parables, how he loved to find lost things, the lost coin, the 99 to go find the one, leaving the 99 to find that one. He loved finding lost things, the parable of the prodigal son.
And then we go from found to free, that there's a process that takes place, that when you become found, that you got to do some work to break free of all the bondage that the enemy has in your life. Right? You don't just accept Jesus and everything's just great from there on out. We realize that I've got to go through a process of learning to die to myself and learn to how to be free in Jesus, free in Christ. That's why Paul, if you read the Pauline epistles, he always uses this phrase, in Christ, because that's where you have to stay. And last week we talked about that as you're going from free to trained, that there is a trainer, a counselor, the Holy Spirit in our lives that guides us into all of that truth. And we need to learn how to use that. That this was a gift that Jesus actually said would be promised to us. The gift of His Spirit leading us, guiding us, being our counselor, being our trainer, being our teacher. And I don't know about you, but I need that in my life. But in the process of that, we also learned that we need others to help us, train us. And guys, I'm just going to be honest with you. As we go in today, learning how to be trained to deploy, I just haven't been able to shake last week's verse. In fact, it's been eating at my soul. And I really felt like I rushed through it last week. I want to read 2 Timothy 1:6 again. And I want you to remember how we talked about the gift of the Holy Spirit and implementing that into our lives. And last week I talked about that the Lord revealed to me through this verse that this is a spiritual farmer. And when you look at spiritual farming, God showed me this. He said, read it backwards. But I want to read in its entirety, but look at this. It says, for this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God. That's that gifting he's talking about. And the gift is the Spirit, and the Spirit will be gifted unto you. And that flame will be lit inside of your heart. And he says to take those gifts and to literally fan them like coals that you have to add oxygen to, and they come alive and they get bright. Fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of many hands. That's the part where others are able to speak and impart and literally send you out. I remember when I was sent out as a pastor that they laid their hands on me. And they said, we're sending you out to preach and teach the gospel. But this is, I want you to read this. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but a spirit of what? Power. Of love. Self-discipline. Here's where I'm going to get honest with you, all of us, including myself. I feel like the Holy Spirit has spoken directly and very, very clear to me on this. That if we are serious, listen to me, about the process, it's going to take us counting the cost and becoming self-disciplined to follow Him. I know that's really hard for us because we want it instantaneous, right? We want this change now. I want to be free now. I want to know how. Right now, it's got to be all done. And we're used to that. I was having this conversation earlier with Jason that we're used to everybody getting the trophy. But in reality, there's a process to be played out here. You've got to run the race. You've got to pick up your cross and follow Him daily. But apart from Him, John 15, you can do nothing. You have to have not only the Holy Spirit as your guide and your leader, your trainer, your teacher, but you need to be a part of those around you and being a part of something more. Going from trained to deployed. That's what we want to talk about. And so, at the end of the day, really what I want to answer is really the holy grail of philosophy. What is the meaning and the purpose of my life? I wish somebody would have been this direct with me when I was young, because I had to learn through my immaturity how to become mature in the greater things of Christ. And so, actually, this is a question that is not new. In fact, at the turn of 1900, John Hopkins University, in 1900, they did a study of college students, and they said, what are you looking for in your first job? And only 16% of those said they wanted to make a lot of money, which, you know, some of us were like, yeah, that's the most important thing. I don't care what I do as long as I make a lot of money.
But 78%, this is 1900, 78% said they just want to find meaning and purpose through their work. 78%. Now, what's interesting is 100 years later, in 2001, they did another study of college students, and they said, what are the top three things that would make a job great for you, that you would love your job? Here's what they are, the top three things. They wanted interesting work, a sense of accomplishment, and they wanted to add something to people's lives. Far down the list was how much money they made. Interesting that over the last 100 years, everyone's still asking the same question. I want to find meaning in what I do. Isn't that where you're at? Hey, I could do any job as long as there was purpose to it. As long as I knew what I was created to do, and this is where God wanted me, I could flip burgers for the rest of my life and that'd be okay. But I want it to be meaningful. I want it to have purpose. And I think that's why so many of us are so hopeless this time of year, because we haven't figured out this biblical principle and that there's a process to this. Anybody ever had a good dessert? Anybody had some desserts this last week? Come on, I had some great desserts. I'm not even a dessert guy. You guys know me. Like peanut butter cookies, that's my favorite dessert, all right? I love peanut butter cookies. All right, not a big chocolate guy, but I like peanut butter cookies. But you know what's interesting about dessert? Is that when you're laying out your ingredients to dessert, they're actually not that good by themselves, are they? I mean, flour by itself, salt by itself, you know, sugar. I mean, it's okay, but too much of it, you're like, whoa, you know, it's like crazy for me. It's like being on Surge. Remember that drink? Like, my mom outlawed it at our house. She's like, no Surge at our house, all right? But what's interesting, though, is when you take those ingredients and you combine them in the right environment, and there's a little bit of sometimes, a lot of times, heat involved. And when they're blended together in the perfect environment, they create something that tastes amazing, right? Today, I want to give you three truths. You can view them however you want. And all three of them are good by themselves. But when you put them together, I really, truly believe that it creates an amazing thing in our lives that you need to know about. So here they are. If you're taking notes, you need to really write each one of these down, and I'm going to tie it together at the end. The first thing that we need to know about, truth number one, is that each and every person has a unique gift that must be discovered and developed. Now, I know this is a little bit piggybacking off of last week, but I really want to go into depth with this. Because I really believe there's a difference between natural gifts and spiritual gifts. You hear that? There's natural gifts and spiritual gifts. But before I explain both of them, let me say this. I don't care if it's a natural gift or a spiritual gift. The key is submitting all of them to God. You hearing that? When you learn to submit these things that God has given you to Him, that is when you become alive and you are just God. Blesses. And let me explain. So a natural gifting is like this. Anybody watch the Olympics this last summer? Let's just be honest. Some people are just born to run. Some people are born to throw. You understand what I'm saying? Like, all of us can run at one time. But not all of us were naturally gifted at running, were we? Some kids you can just know. You can watch when they're 3, 4 years old. You're like, wow, that kid is an athlete. They're just born at it. They're natural at it. They don't even have to try good, and they're good at it. Right? Now, I want to give, especially you young people, I've told this before, but I think this is gold. And John Maxwell talks about this. He says that all of us have natural gifting. The problem is that most of us aren't honest with how good we're actually at them, all right? So, if you were to put on a scale of 0 to 10, like, who is the best at anything? Like, the Michael Jordan of anything, all right? He's a 10. There's only, like, less than 1% that are a 10 at anything, okay? What John
Maxwell says, and I think this is gold for all of us, is that all of us have a natural gifting. And if you want to actually make money doing that natural gifting, you have to be at least a 7 on the Richter scale. That means, and here's the other caveat to that, is that you can only go 2 places above your natural gifting. In other words, you need to start out at least a 5 natural gifting in order to make a living doing a natural gifting type of talent of work. Now, I know there's an exception to every rule, but I really think this is gold. And let me give you an example of this. I love to golf. I like golfing. Natural gifting at golfing, it took me 1.5 years to get rid of my slice. Do you think I'm a natural golfer? Absolutely not. When I started out at golf, I was probably a 2 or 3 at best. I could work and work and work, and I could get trainers, and I could get people to help me out. But you know, I'm probably not ever going to get above a 5. A 5 is just somebody who's average at golf. And I'm okay with that. The problem is if I had aspirations to be like, oh no, I'm great at golf. I'm going to go make a living at golf. And I'm going to put my time and energy and effort into something that I'm really not naturally gifted at. I see this happen in people's lives all the time. We see it on American Idol every single year, right? They go through like, bro, you cannot sing. Like, are you listening to the same thing I am? No, I'm great. I've spent thousands and thousands of dollars. And listen, none of this is necessarily bad. You hear me out? It's not bad. It's not bad for me to want to go golf. But the problem is we only have so much time to develop our skills and our natural gifting. Now, if I knew a natural gifting for me from when I was little was public speaking. It just was. 2nd grade, I was going to 4-H things and winning public speaking competitions. I was naturally gifted at it. I didn't have to struggle at it. Some people are terrified of it. It did not scare me. All right? I was naturally gifted at it. Now, if I take a natural gifting and I use it and submit it unto the Lord and He blesses it, then I'm able to use it. In fact, He called me into using it to be a teacher, a preacher, right? But then we have our spiritual gifting. Spiritual giftings, many times, are things that are there, but you may not know that they are there. There's something that sometimes, either through the Holy Spirit, or maybe somebody around you, that they pointed out. And what's crazy about this is I've been a Christian long enough to see that this always isn't like this, you know, grand, like I'm going to become, you know, like an intercessory prayer. Like, that's amazing if God has given you that gift. But, like, a lot of us only view spiritual giftings like that. But listen, I've met people that could not draw a lick. I've seen their work. They were not an artist. And they got saved. And then all of a sudden, they made the most incredible creations that you've ever seen in your life. I believe that that was a God gift to them. Some people can't sing. I'm one of them. I got saved, and it didn't change. But listen to me. I have met people that could not sing. And they gave their life to Jesus, and later on, they were amazing. And you're like, what happened? Sometimes God just touches people with a physical gift. And other times, these spiritual gifts are developed over time through learning, through empowering, through testing. I didn't know I was even good at that. Some people don't realize they're a good public speaker. They were terrified of it, but when God comes in, He gives them the gift. He says, go preach my word. Go teach my word. One of my favorite holiness preachers, Steve Deneff, his whole life was a stutterer. He couldn't get through anything without stuttering. And now he's one. I love listening to him teach the word of God. He's amazing. But he'll tell you, like, it wasn't until I submitted my will and my way unto the Lord that I was able to speak clearly. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that what God does? I mean, you think about this. There are people in the Bible. And too many times when we think about church, we only think about teachers and speakers. All right? We need to repent of that as a church as a whole. Church is not just the speakers and teachers. In fact, when you look at Scripture, whether it was natural gifts or a spiritual gift, it was often those that played the background that became the heroes of the story. Let me give you 3 practical examples really quick, okay? The first example would be Noah. Do you think Noah didn't know how to use a hammer? I don't believe that. I really believe that Noah was probably an amazing craftsman. And once I went to the Ark experience, I really realized that he just wasn't good with a hammer, but this guy was an amazing engineer. And yes, he probably had divine inspiration on how to build this thing. But I believe that God took somebody that had a gifting and he said, I'm going to bless it, and you're going to build a boat, an ark, and you're going to save the world through it. Isn't that amazing? What about King David? You see, I've thought a lot about this one throughout the week. What were David's natural giftings and what was his spiritual giftings? Here's what I came to conclude. This is my own conclusion. These are my own theories. And this doesn't mean that I need to go write a book about it, okay? But here's what I'll tell you what I think, okay? This is just my own thought, my own theory. I think that David was naturally gifted with his hands. Why? How do I know that? Because he could play the harp. I believe he was naturally, in fact, he was so good at it, if you read the scriptures, that he was invited into the king's chamber to play for him. This was before he went and played the giant. He was naturally gifted at playing the harp. He was really good at it. He was also good with his slingshot, wasn't he? With his hands. He was naturally gifted with his hands. But here's the thing. When he submitted them unto God, look what God did with them. Now, spiritually, I thought this was amazing. This was a Holy Spirit moment. I said, yeah, but Lord, what about the spiritual giftings? He said, that's when he was out being a shepherd. And that's where I taught him how to lead. And I prepared him to be a king. He probably wasn't, this is my own theory. Maybe he wasn't a naturally gifted shepherd. But because God had him in that place of shepherding, he was able to identify and develop skills and develop things that would prepare him for what God had for him. Did you hear that, church? Some of you are at a job you don't like. Some of you are at school and you're like, this is pointless, this is dumb. I don't know why God has me here. And I'm here to tell you, if you will submit that time and your talent to him, and God will breathe on it, he might be, I'm not saying he is, but he might be preparing you for something you don't even and can't even see down the road. Nobody would have looked at David and said, David, God's preparing you to be a king. That would have never have happened to him. But he was just being faithful in what God had already given to him. I think both with the spiritual things and with the natural giftings that he has for them. Guys, what about the disciples, for crying out loud? We're talking about fishermen, tax collectors, doctors, servants, just regular old Joes that Jesus called, and they submitted their wills and their ways, and yes, even their talents unto him, and Jesus was able to develop all of them, and after 3 years was able to send them out and literally turn the world upside down. With 12 ordinary people that just said, here's my giftings, here's what I need to do, and they found their purpose in life. Church, are you following? We have spiritual gifts, and we have natural gifts. Some of those spiritual gifts have to be called out. And Paul talks about this in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. He says, now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church. Listen to this. The apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers. Check this out. I've always missed this. Their responsibility. You see that? I underlined it. Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do the work and build up the church, the body of Christ. It's not the teachers and the preachers that are the heroes of the story, is it? It's those that are equipping. The apostles, the teachers, the leaders are supposed to be equipping all of us to go and do the good work, to fan into flame like we've been talking about. And this will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith and the knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. Then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed and blown about by every wind or new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever they sound like the truth. Instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is at the head of the body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly, and each part does its own special work. It helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing into maturity, into growing and becoming full as Jesus intended it. What was it? It was the church. And as we submit to Him, we start with the Holy Spirit, and we look around us, and we look who God is putting into our lives, and we use them to help make us grow and better as we're being led, like I talked about last week, through the Holy Spirit. But church, I want you to be warned of this. Be warned of this. How we use our gifts will be much different than the way the world will tell us to use our gifts. And listen, that can be spiritual too. The world will tell you to use your gifts for your benefit, to lift you up, to support you. The world will tell you to use your gifts for your glorification. But Peter actually outlines this very clear. 1 Peter 4, verse 10. God has given each of you a gift from His great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well, I underline it, what's it say? To serve one another. Do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God Himself were speaking through you. Do you have the gift of helping others? Do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. Then everything you do will be glory to God through Jesus Christ. Your giftings, whether they're spiritual or whether they're natural, are meant to serve others. Do you understand that, church? They're not to glorify yourself. They're not to bring self-glorification. And when you come alive is when you stop looking at yourself and you start to serve other people. Now, I want you to be careful. And I've read this story to you. I've preached from this message earlier this year, and I want to read this story with the woman at the well one more time, but I want you to listen with intent ears of people that sometimes they get caught up serving, and when we don't serve out of the right heart and the right place, we actually end up missing our purpose. John 4, 17 through 15. Let's read this story real quick and let's break it down. Verse 7, soon a Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, please give me a drink. He was alone at the time because the disciples had gone into the village to buy some food. The woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. She said to Jesus, you are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for a drink? Jesus replied, if you only knew, look at this, the gift God has for you, and who you are speaking to, you would ask me, and I would give you living water. Isn't that interesting? He said he wanted to give her a gift, remember? God has for you a gift, if you knew the gift God has for you. But, sir, you don't have a rope or a bucket, she said, and this well is very deep. Where would you get this living water? And besides, do you think you're greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well? How can you offer better water than he and his sons and his animals enjoy? Jesus replied, anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life. Please, sir, the woman said, give me this water. Then I'll never be thirsty again, and I won't have to come here to get water. Do you see what happened in the story? She was serving. She was doing what she knew to do, to go get water each day. And yes, there's a lot of background to this story, and I preached that in a different message. But what I want us to recognize here is that until you drink of the living water and learn to use your gifts to serve others, you fully and truly won't come alive. Do you understand that? It wasn't until she came into contact with the living God, to Jesus Christ himself, that she was changed. And that her life then had purpose. What'd she do? She ended up going back and telling the whole village about this man, Jesus, who told her everything that she had ever done, right? She got purpose. And many of us will be serving and doing, but until you fill the void with Jesus, you can serve, but you are trying to fill something that can only be filled by Jesus. You hear that? She kept trying to fill a void in her life, spiritually and physically, right? To fill her life with her physical body with water, but she also was trying to find all of these different things in life to fill her emotionally and spiritually. But it wasn't until she came and drank the living water that she found her purpose. And that's truth number three, church. Your purpose is tied to the work of Jesus Christ. Listen, it's not just serving. Some of you have figured that out. I'm just going to be honest with you. You figured out, I can serve at church. I can serve, but I still feel empty. If you're serving outside of a purpose tied to Jesus, you're still going to feel empty because you haven't drank of the living water. Do you understand this principle, church? It's not just about being busy. It's not just about working. It's working with a purpose. It's working knowing that I'm making a difference. Church, I want to ask you a serious question. What are you doing right now that will matter 1,000 years from now? What are you doing? Nobody's going to remember 1,000 years what we ate for Thanksgiving dinner 2021. Being a part of what Jesus is doing has ripple effects, not just for 1,000 years, but for eternity. You understand that? In other words, there is nothing more important for you to be a part of than what God is doing right now. And when we realize that and we put all of these truths together, we truly find our true purpose. Because that purpose and that mission is not hidden from us. It really isn't. You guys know where I'm going next, right? Because you've been with us for a while. Matthew 28. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Here's what you need to do, church. There is nothing in this world, nothing, that will allow you to do everything in the Great Commission like the local church. As messed up as it is, trust me, I can exchange war stories with you about the local church all day long, all right? I've been there. I've done that. I've heard some of your guys' stories. I know the local church isn't perfect, but I'm here to tell you there is not another thing on this planet that can do all of those things in one place like the local church can. Nothing. And that's what he talks about. That's why Paul writes about the church. Because it doesn't matter if you're a builder, a painter. Guess what? We can use your gifts. It doesn't matter if you can hold open a door. You're holding open a door for people to come and experience the gospel where they can learn to be transformed and changed and discipled and learn to obey all of its truth. It doesn't matter if you can just be with kids and make them laugh. You're sowing seeds of hope and love into their lives. It doesn't matter if you can play the drums or you can serve coffee. If you submit your will and your way and your giftings unto Him, it can be used for the glorification of only Jesus Christ. And then you can find your true purpose and meaning. here's what I want you to do with the Great Commission. Can you go back to that slide one more time? Matthew 28. I want you to look at this. Here's what I want you to do, all of us. I want you to stop looking at the Great Commission like a task. And I want you to start looking at it as a thing to implement your God-gifting ability into the Great Commission. You understand? It's not a task. This is something that God gave us and said, go and do these things. And as we do that, we submit. We are trained and we are deployed to go and implement this, to do this. Now, here's where I want to give you the special sauce. Everybody that has a great dessert, I like to smoke meat. There's always a trick. They'll give you the ingredients, but there's always a trick involved. You understand what I'm saying? Like the Texas Crunch. Like, some of you know what that is, some of you don't. But that's a trick. And they don't tell you to do that. They just tell you how to do it, how to make it. But there's a process. There's a little thing in there, that one little thing that changes everything. I want you to see this. This is usually where I bring out my blackboard, you know, but they can't see it online. So I made this for you. Go to this. This is how you discover your purpose. We discover our purpose when we submit all three of those things, our giftings and our passions, when we learn to use those to serve others, and we do it to help propel the Great Commission by sharing the gospel through them, right? And when we put all those ingredients, the flour, the sugar, the salt, all those special things together, and it's in the right place and in the right environment, then we discover that this is an amazing thing, right? That it's almost like that dessert. It's like, wow. You can eat each one of these by themselves, but man, when you put them in the right spot, in the right place, with the right heat, in the right environment, wow, God just breathes on it. And it's amazing, right? But I want to show you one thing. Don't go there yet. I want to show you one thing that I think, as I was processing this, that is the special sauce, that special ingredient, that one thing that kind of brings it all together. You know what that one thing was? It's the commitment. When you connect with others with all three of those things, that's when relationally it comes alive. Isn't that true of what we've been saying? Transformation doesn't happen in rows, it happens in circles. We've been saying all the time, you can't just use your gifts. You can find out your gifts and your passions, but if you don't use it to serve others, you're not really coming alive. And when you don't do it to propel the gospel and to glorify Jesus, you're all doing it in vain for yourself. It's not just one of these three. And some of us, we're trying to do that. Let's just be honest about that. You might be stuck in finding out your giftings and your passions and what God has really created you to do because you're not doing this in the wholeness of what God wants to do. It's got to be in the right place. It has to be at the right time. It has to be at the right temperature or it doesn't work. And you know what? All the time, I can't explain that away. Nobody could probably explain to David why he was out in the middle of nowhere watching sheep. You understand what I'm saying now? But he didn't just fluff it off. He was like, I'm going to use this time. I'm going to use these giftings that God has given to me. And whenever God reveals to me the right time, the right place, the right temperature, God is going to use that. Isn't that cool? And if we start from the premise that God is good, what are you afraid of? You hear me, church? That's why we have hope. You don't want hope, just watch the news. We're talking about submitting our wills and our ways to Jesus. And when we do that in the right way, we truly come alive. Listen, and I know some of you, I had to say this. I wasn't going to, but I have to. Some of you think these sermons are just self-seeking and self-serving to me or Alan. Oh, you just want us to serve and to give money and to give our time and talents so that we get a big church and you guys can make more money and blah, 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 blah. I want that. I want you to come alive. I want you to find purpose in your life, like I found in mine. Am I perfect? Absolutely not. But there's nothing I'd rather be doing than serving the local church. Flawed as it may be, it's the only place I can find all of this. And where God refines me and makes me better and more transformed into his image. I wish there was something else. I wish it didn't sound self-serving. But I'm here to tell you that I love serving. I love serving all of you. I love serving this church with the good things that God has given to you. And I want you to find that same thing. My job, remember, is to equip you to fan the flame. I'm just the teacher and the speaker. What will make Broadcast different than every other church is not me. It's you. Broadcasting the hope and the love of Jesus Christ to a dying, dead, hopeless world. That's what I want to be known for. That's what I want to be a part of. But I want to emphasize this. Knowing what you're made for is always second to knowing Christ. You hear that? Some of you are so with what you're supposed to be doing and purpose in your life and finding the right job and finding the right husband and finding the right wife, finding the right way to serve, finding for you. For you. And you've forgotten, like the woman at the well, the living water that God wants to give you. And apart from that, you'll never find purpose. You can serve all day long inside the church, the walls of the church, and you still will not find your purpose. Because every single thing that we do here at Broadcast, we are trying to point people towards the saving grace of Jesus Christ. From our children's ministry all the way up to our adults and discipleship process, there's nothing more that I want for that to come to fruition. It's not about being busy. It's about submitting. Thank you, the Lord. So as we close out service, I want you to look at this kind of list for finding purpose. And I want you to step into your purpose. In other words, I want you to step in to a true relationship with Jesus Christ. Not just, I believe, a true, self-disciplined, walking, talking, praying, circling type of relationship with Jesus Christ that will transform you. I'm going to say it. Going to church isn't going to be enough. An hour a week is not going to cut it. You hear me, church? Do you truly want to be transformed? Truly want to find purpose, you truly want to be transformed into his image, then you got to quit putting in the middle. You got to be all in. You got to step into a church to serve others. You got to step into being led by his Holy Spirit. What are you doing, God? What are you teaching me? How can I submit right now to you? And you need to step into living on mission with others by connecting. That's what I believe God wants to give to all of us. A life-giving, transforming body of Christ. Listen, that is not complete without you. You hear that? It's not complete without you. We truly are better together. You need me. I need you. That's what we want to step into this season, this Advent season, and truly find hope. Heavenly Father, teacher, counselor, Almighty God. Thank you for teaching us, molding us into your image. I pray right now in the name of Jesus that maybe somebody here is, maybe somebody online at home feeling convicted about where they're at, why they're stuck. And maybe it's because they truly haven't gone from lost to found. They truly haven't had that salvation moment. All you have to do is submit to Him. Here's my life, Lord. I lay it down. I believe in you. He's my Savior and my King. Some of you are stuck at going from found to free because you truly haven't surrendered all to Him. You've surrendered some to Him, but you haven't surrendered all to Him. Maybe it's your will. Maybe it's the job. Maybe it's the relationship. Whatever it might be, submit it unto Him. Some of you are walking powerless because you've never submitted to the will of the Holy Spirit in your life. And I pray that over you right now, that if you've never heard Him, that you would ask to be led by Him, and that you'll learn His Word, and you'll learn how to apply it to your life, and that His Holy Spirit would magnify it and breathe on it and fan it into flame so that it becomes fruit in your life. A fruit that never could be taken away. A living water where you'll never thirst again. Receive that Holy Spirit to be led by Him. And some of you need to take the next step. You need to go from praying to deploy them. You need to live on mission. Live on mission at home. Live on mission in the workplace. Live on mission at the grocery store. Wherever God has you, in the wilderness or as the king, whatever it is, like King David, I pray that you submit to His will and His way and live on mission for Jesus' glory and honor and praise, and not your own. Heavenly Father, lead us and guide us. Reveal this to us. We are so excited about what you're going to do. I pray right now for the empty seats in this room that we will be bold, that we will reach out, that we will live on purpose and with your passion through the giftings, physical and natural and spiritual, that you've given to us for your glory and honor and praise. Help us, Lord, to be more like your Son, transformed in His image. Made new by your leading. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray.
Worthy of all the praise we could ever give. Worthy of every breath we could ever give. Your Son. Worthy of every breath we could ever give.
Father, help us always trust in you, that we will not be shaken like the immature child who's thrown to the left and to the right by every wind that comes along, every foolish thought or every foolish thing that we're taught. But God, that we submit it unto you, to your word and your truth, and that we become mature followers of you, standing on the firm foundation of Jesus Christ, giving you all the praise and honor and glory for the furtherment of your kingdom. Thank you, Jesus. We are so grateful that you are a good God who wants to impart good gifts to his children. We love you, Lord. Guys, we are so grateful for all of you. Before Julia walks out the door, can you give her a round of applause for all that she does? She's amazing. Listen, church, we're so grateful for your giving. We can't do what we do without your tithes and offerings and giving to this church. I do want to bring up something that I felt convicted about today. The Lord says you have not because you ask not. Amen. And sometimes we use that for everything but the things that we need. And I can try to theologically just kind of, I'll just kind of try to push it out the door. You know, oh no, that God, you would not tell me to do that. You wouldn't tell me to ask for that. Right? God kind of convicted my spirit this morning, so I'm just going to ask. Our children's ministry needs a new computer really bad. And we need a Mac because all of our programs are run on Mac. And the Lord told me just to ask. If somebody would like to donate one of those, we would be forever grateful. If you want to know what to buy, come talk to me or Alan, and we will point you in the right direction. But we have tried every week to try to make it work and last, and I just think it's time to call it quits sometimes. So I'm just going to ask. We need a financial blessing, and we need to keep growing in His Word, keep growing in our gifting, to keep growing financially as well so we can continue to sow seeds of the gospel into this community. Amen. So I'm just asking. The Lord lays that on your heart, come talk to us, and we'll make that happen. But God is always our provider, amen. He's always good. And we are grateful for that. So you can give online, you can give text to give, you can write a check. You can work out a way to where your bank sends us your tithe every week. We have several families that do that. But with that being said, can I just challenge you on one thing? I do believe there's something about bringing that gift to the Lord. Even if you give online, can I just say, mentally, bring that gift to the Lord. Don't just be like, oh, it came out of the bank today. No, no, no. I want you to pray over it and lay it down. Even if it's mentally, just say, Lord, here's what you've given to me. I'm giving it back to you. And trust me with everything that I have. Thank you, Lord, for always providing giving you everything that I can. We love you. I pray that that is our prayer today. Go before us. Make our paths straight. We love you.